une famille. La disparition d'Isabelle Laville, âgée de 17 ans, près d'Auxerre, est toujours inexpliquée. Isabelle Laville porte un manteau de ménage gris-bleu foncé, un jean, des bottes blanches, et elle a les cheveux longs, châtain clair.
Le 11 décembre 1987, mon mari et moi, on s'est couchés sur le canapé, on a ouvert le canapé-lit, on a laissé la lumière dehors toute la nuit et on n'a pas dormi. Dès qu'on entendait le bruit, on allait à la porte pour voir, mais... Et il a fait froid, cette nuit-là, il a fait froid. Il n'avait pas fait froid comme ça depuis longtemps. Ma fille n'est pas rentrée à la maison. Elle a disparu de la surface de la terre, sans laisser de traces, sans rien, sans... Ça a été vraiment un énorme choc. Le matin, à midi, elle était là, le soir, elle n'était plus là. Ils ont assassiné nos filles. C'était nos enfants. Il y a le tueur en série, il y a sa compagne. Sans elle, il n'aurait pas réussi à faire tout ce qu'il a fait. C'est elle que je rends coupable de tout. C'est cette femme immonde qui a mis des enfants au monde et qui n'a pas respecté les enfants des autres.
Forestier français inculpé en Belgique pour des rapts de mineurs et des attentats à la pudeur. Son épouse vient de l'accuser de 9 meurtres d'enfants et de jeunes filles.
10 meurtres au moins, des viols presque toujours Isabelle. D'après les experts, c'est le tueur en série le plus abouti de France.
Quand il est pu arriver à Estelle, vous devez nous la rendre.
La série meurtrière de l'ogre des Ardennes et de sa femme a épouvanté l'Europe entière.
D'une adolescente qui avait disparu il y a 10 mois aurait été retrouvée en Belgique.
Les Fourniret auraient violé et tué des jeunes filles en France, en Belgique, avec un sadisme et une méticulosité extrême.
La femme de Michel Fourniret se présente comme une femme soumise, qui a peur de son mari et qui n'a donc pas parlé jusqu'à présent.
C'est une ménagère. Qui aide à violer, qui aide à tuer, qui aide à enlever. Mais le résultat, c'est le ménagère.
Si on fait pas si cher.
J'ai eu des affaires de violeurs, de pédophiles en série, des meurtres absolument horribles, gratuits, horribles. J'ai eu des affaires marquantes pendant 41 ans de carrière, mais l'affaire Fourniret Olivier, naturellement, dépasse très très loin tout ça. Mentalement, moralement, personne n'en est jamais vraiment sorti indemne. Ça, c'est certain. Des tueurs en série, on en a connu quelques-uns, mais seul, solitaire. Là, il n'était pas solitaire, il était avec Monique Olivier. Je suis nommé en janvier 2003 procureur à Charleville-Mézières. J'entends parler de Michel Fourniret pour la première fois, je m'en souviens de manière très précise. C'est le commandant du SRP Gidrin qui me téléphone en me disant « Voilà, les Belges viennent d'arrêter un certain Michel Fourniret à la suite d'une tentative d'enlèvement. » Et là, ce qui nous a tout de suite marqué, c'est les déclarations de la petite qui avait été enlevée.
Il y a un monsieur qui m'a demandé justement pour aller au magasin Et j'ai montré.
La petite, elle dit, moi pour le rendre service, je monte dans le véhicule. Là, son comportement change tout en tout. Il a les yeux qui deviennent un peu translucides. Et ça, j'ai remarqué personnellement en plusieurs replis, qui est extrêmement terrorisant. Il me demande si je suis vierge. Donc, il me dit qu'il va prendre ma virginité. Quand je lui demande s'il va me tuer, il me dit non, avec un sourire jusqu'aux oreilles. Le sourire qui veut dire exactement l'inverse. Complètement paniqué, je sais que je vais mourir.
Là, il m'a attaché les mains et les pieds et le corps derrière avec la camionnette.
Il la met à l'arrière de son fourgon et puis il démarre.
J'ai commencé à paniquer beaucoup. Et j'ai commencé à prier.
La gamine a une présence d'esprit, un sang-froid tout à fait exceptionnel. Elle réussit à se désentraver. Elle profite d'un arrêt du faucon qui fournirait un stop pour s'enfuir.
Des fouilles ont débuté aujourd'hui dans une maison des Ardennes belges. Michel Fourniret est inculpé par la justice belge d'enlèvement de mineurs et d'attentat à la pudeur.
La première perquisition chez Michel Fourniret a lieu le lendemain de son arrestation, le 27 juin 2003. On a évidemment toujours en tête ce qui s'est passé chez nous avec l'enquête sur Marc Dutroux qui avait fortement ébranlé l'opinion publique en Belgique quelques années plus tôt. Il y a automatiquement une pression de l'opinion publique, une pression médiatique. On a utilisé des gros moyens comme un géoradar au niveau du jardin, des pelleteuses, tout moyen qui devait, entre guillemets, nous garantir de ne pas passer à côté de quelque chose. Les Ardennes, c'est une région qu'on partage avec la France, où règne quelque part un culte de la discrétion et du silence. Des collègues parlent parfois d'une forme d'omerta sur ce qui se passe. On n'est pas indiscret, on ne va pas voir ce qui se passe chez les autres, on ne s'en occupe pas. Si on apprend des choses, on ne les évoquera peut-être pas. Les voisins décrivent le couple Fourniret comme étant triste, ne dégageant pas de joie de vivre. Des gens qui vivent de façon assez secrète au sein du village.
Ils sont venus une dizaine d'années acheter cette maison. Et alors, au début, ça allait, mais après, il n'a plus venu par. À travailler à l'intérieur de sa maison, vous croyez, rien d'autre.
Il était agressif avec le voisinage, il était vraiment spécial. Il voyait des chats, il les tuait, parce que ça le dérangeait qu'il passe dans le jardin. Ben, il les enterrait chez lui.
N'étiez-vous moins copain, monsieur Fourniret? Vous n'êtes pas un couple normal.
Vous avez confié des choses plus intimes?
Ben, disons que plus intimes, oui. Apparemment, Michel n'avait pas plus d'attirance.
On va dire que c'était une femme qui était très expansive, pas souriante, pas beaucoup causante, mais gentille, gentille, douce.
Alors qu'on est sur place, arrive Monique Olivier, donc l'épouse de Michel Fourniret. C'est une dame sans attrait physique particulier, une apparence de sorcière, mais c'est peut-être un peu excessif aussi, avec ses longs cheveux noirs et son visage assez apathique. Elle n'avait pas été mise au courant de l'arrestation de Fourniret la veille, mais son absence d'une nuit ne l'étonnait pas. Ça lui arrivait.
Ben, il faut bien, il mène la vie qu'il veut. Hein, il rentre quand il veut, il part quand il veut, il part plusieurs jours. C'est lui, elle n'a rien à dire. C'est une femme soumise, craintive, qui regarde ses chaussures en permanence. Qui semble être la pauvre malheureuse du coin, elle est plutôt cloîtrée à la maison.
Dans la maison, c'est assez mal rangé, hein, c'est une espèce de cafarnaüm. Ce qu'on va trouver qui nous intéresse et qui va nous permettre de travailler, ce sont des téléphones mobiles. Ce sont aussi des documents dans lesquels on espère trouver des éléments d'information pour la suite.
Lors de la perquisition de missiles fournirait, c'est édifiant. C'est édifiant. Parce qu'on retrouve à la cave des menottes. On retrouve des vêtements d'enfants. On retrouve des masques inhalateurs pour dormir. On retrouve des préservatifs. On retrouve des pistolets, des armes de poing. On retrouve donc des cordes, du scotch, des bâillons, des cagoules. On retrouve vraiment la panoplie soit du braqueur, soit de quelqu'un d'autre, mais des choses très graves, quoi. Enfin, le masque inhalateur, des choses comme ça, c'est des ampoules de terre, enfin, vous voyez. Bon.
Manny Colline, il ne comprend de rien, elle ne sait rien, elle n'a rien vu. On a vraiment l'impression d'avoir affaire à la nouille de service, quoi. Hein. La femme soumise, qui ne pose pas de questions.
Mais on sent qu'elle peut effectivement apporter des éléments à l'enquête, qu'elle a sans doute des choses à nous dire. Parce qu'à ce moment-là, on se dit qu'on a affaire à un client sérieux, à quelqu'un qui a commis d'autres faits de ce type.
Les enquêteurs, bien sûr, travaillent sur cette personnalité. Ce qu'ils disent, c'est que c'est bien sûr un pervers dangereux, voire extrêmement dangereux. Eh bien, on se doute que les enquêteurs de Dinan sont évidemment inquiets. Ils veulent tout vérifier et on essaye surtout de ne laisser derrière soi aucune victime.
On se dit qu'on ne peut pas passer à côté d'un cas qui n'a pas été élucidé et dans lequel il pourrait être impliqué.
On a le sentiment très fort que c'est peut-être un pédophile en série. Et peut-être même plus qu'un pédophile, un meurtrier d'enfants. Il y a d'autres victimes.
Je m'appelle Daniel Bourgard, je suis commandant de police, et j'ai fait ma carrière au SRPJ de Reims. Le 17 mai 2000, je reçois un appel téléphonique d'un adjudant de gendarmerie qui me téléphone pour me dire que sa nièce, qui habite Charleville, donc Céline Saison, a disparu. Et il me dit, écoute, il semblerait que le commissariat croit une fugue. Et il dit, moi je peux te dire, je connais ma nièce, je connais le contexte. En aucun cas, ça ne peut être une fugue. Et c'est une disparition inquiétante, essaie de t'intéresser à ça. On va travailler dans cette optique-là, on va faire des recherches, mais ça ne donne rien. Jusqu'au 22 juillet, où là, on va retrouver un corps en Belgique, juste après la frontière, qu'on va rapidement identifier comme étant celui de Céline Saison. Et un an après, donc le 5 mai 2001, une seconde jeune fille a disparu à Sedan.
Il y a un mois, jour pour jour, que Manani a disparu. La jeune fille âgée de 13 ans a été aperçue pour la dernière fois à la sortie de la médiathèque de Sedan. La piste de la fugue écartée, sa mère attend depuis des nouvelles et veut croire que sa fille est toujours vivante.
Malaga, c'est une gamine de 12 ans, très rieuse, très joueuse. Son surnom, c'était Eyes, ça veut dire les yeux. Quand elle est venue au monde, sa maman m'a dit qu'on voyait que ses yeux. Donc, elle a trouvé son surnom comme ça. Je crois que c'est l'enfant que tous les parents rêvent d'avoir. Je ne l'ai pas connu longtemps, mais c'était... Le peu que j'ai connu, le début, c'était magnifique. Mai 2001, je suis parti aux environs de 2h30, 3h de l'après-midi avec sa maman faire les courses dans un supermarché à Charleville. Et la gamine, elle part à la médiathèque. On rentre, du coup, on ne voit pas la gamine. Elle devait être rentrée à 5h. 5h30, je ne vois toujours pas. Et tout de suite avec une photo en montrant la gamine que vous ne l'auriez pas vue. C'était impensable qu'elle parte d'elle-même et que je ne dise pas où elle est. C'était impensable.
Les recherches se poursuivent pour retrouver Manania Tumpong avec de nouveaux moyens. Hier, un hélicoptère a survolé la zone. Il y a aussi eu des fouilles en Belgique. L'adolescente a disparu près de Sedan depuis bientôt 2 semaines.
Les restes d'une adolescente qui avait disparu il y a 10 mois à Sedan, dans le nord-est de la France, aurait été retrouvé en Belgique. C'est un promeneur qui a découvert un crâne et des effets personnels dans un bois. La mère de la fillette a pu formellement les identifier.
Ma femme s'est effondrée.
Dans l'imaginaire policier, au début des années 2000, on est dans le noir le plus total. On n'est pas certain des conditions dans lesquelles ont été donnés la mort. On ne sait pas s'il y a des violences sexuelles, on ne peut pas l'affirmer. À l'époque, on n'a pas de caméra dans la rue, on n'a pas de téléphone portable, il n'y a pas de géolocalisation. Si vous voulez, les enquêteurs cherchent tous azimuts parce qu'on est complètement dans le brouillard. Donc pendant 2 ans et demi, on va ramer parce qu'on n'a pas un véhicule, on n'a pas un signalement d'individu, un nom d'individu, on n'a rien, rien, rien. Le jour où Michel Fourniret se fait arrêter, la connexion avec Manania et Céline est évidente. Géographiquement, les faits se situent dans le même secteur. Pour reconnaître, on a l'enlèvement de Céline Saison à Charleville-Mézières, de Manania Tumpong à Sedan, les découvertes de leurs cadavres qui sont environ à 10-15 km au-dessus de Sedan. On trouve au-dessus le domicile de Fourniret et en 20 km au-dessus le lieu d'enlèvement de la petite Marie Ascension. Donc on est vraiment dans un mouchoir de poche. Tout se fait dans une bande de 20 km sur 40, on va dire. Donc là, il est évident qu'à ce moment-là, sans être archi-catégorique, hein, franchement, c'est l'hypothèse Fourniret nous plaît bien. Et à ce moment-là, je me dis qu'on est vraisemblablement en présence de l'auteur de nos 2 enlèvements.
Ce qui est devenu très vite une certitude des policiers, c'est que Fourniret n'est pas n'importe qui. C'est un personnage extrêmement fermé, extrêmement manipulateur, extrêmement malin. Et malgré tout ce qu'on essaye de lui mettre sous le nez, de tous les interrogatoires qui sont faits, ça ne donne rien. Et c'est un vrai désespoir de travailler avec quelqu'un comme Fourniret ou de l'interroger sans que ça ne donne rien. D'où évidemment l'idée que peut-être que Mme Olivier serait le maillon faible. C'est une femme normale, elle n'a aucun antécédent, elle n'est pas connue, on n'a aucune raison de la soupçonner de quoi que ce soit. Ce qu'essaye de faire l'enquêteur principal à l'époque, c'est de convaincre Mme Olivier de dire « Aidez-nous, s'il a fait des choses graves, c'est le moment de le dire. » C'est un travail presque de sape, je dirais, et psychologique auprès de Mme Olivier pour essayer de l'amener à donner des éléments qu'elle connaîtrait.
Même si elle est libre, on travaille sur elle, on l'entend très souvent. C'est des auditions très pénibles, c'est très lent, c'est presque inaudible aussi. C'est toute cette attitude très fermée, très taiseuse, très renfermée, créative à la limite, avec de très longs silences.
Baisse la tête, ses grands cheveux qui tombent devant, et puis là, ça dure 5 minutes, 10 minutes, où elle fait rien. Elle fait rien, sinon, de temps en temps, non. silencieusement. Signe oui, signe non, puis se repasse encore de longues minutes, rien. Puis un petit non, comme si elle était en train de réfléchir profondément. Voilà, c'est ça les interrogatoires de mon économie.
Franchement, je ne sais rien. Je me rends compte de la gravité de la situation. Mon mari travaillait normalement à la maison et je n'ai jamais remarqué un quelconque élément qui aurait pu me faire douter de son comportement.
Les premières impressions que les enquêteurs ont eues, c'est qu'elle le protégeait. Manifestement, elle n'avait pas du tout envie d'impliquer Fouliret dans quoi que ce soit. Elle est dépendante psychologiquement, matériellement, et certainement sous l'influence de Fouliret, qui est un personnage extrêmement dur, qui ne tolère aucune contestation, qui peut s'avérer évidemment brutal, violent avec elle. On peut comprendre même qu'elle en ait peur.
On voit bien qu'on a deux personnalités, une personnalité forte et une personnalité faible. C'est vraiment le solitaire, il pense qu'à lui, il n'y a que lui qui existe, et Manique Olivier, elle représente la soumission personnifiée, elle n'a rien à dire. Fourniret sort, il part, il travaille dans les bois, après on va apprendre au fur et à mesure qu'il s'absente des fois plusieurs jours. Il est capable de faire le cahier en France pendant 15 jours avec des sandwichs. Voir du pain qu'il achètera, du jambon blanc qu'il achètera, qu'il mangera dans le camion. C'est son mode de vie, effectivement.
À un moment donné, on aurait peut-être eu tendance à renoncer, mais on sent qu'on touche à quelque chose de concret qu'on peut relier à Michel Fourniret, à des enfers non élucidés, d'une conviction policière. On savait qu'on était dans le bon. Après, il fallait encore le démontrer. Les vagues de perquisition ont permis de rassembler un maximum d'éléments et c'est ainsi qu'un ticket de station d'essence, un ticket de restaurant, un document de péage va nous permettre de reconstituer son parcours et d'identifier sa présence à un endroit où a eu lieu il y a quelques années un enlèvement de jeunes filles.
Formidable chaîne de solidarité qui s'est créée à Auxerre autour d'une famille dans l'angoisse. On recherche une jeune fille de 17 ans, Isabelle Laville. À Auxerre, tout le monde s'est mobilisé et c'est le club de football bien connu qui en a été le moteur.
Si les personnes donnent des indices décisifs, ils seront récompensés par des chèques très importants, parce qu'il n'y en aura peut-être pas qu'une, c'est pas un seul indice qui va permettre de la retrouver. Ils seront tous récompensés par des chèques importants et le financement de cette somme sera donné par un match que nous ferons ici.
J'ai été très très touchée de voir que la France se mobilise pour ma fille. Avec le recul, je dirais que c'était formidable. Ça n'a rien donné. Ma soeur et moi, on était très très proches. On s'entendait vraiment comme deux grandes amies toutes les deux. On pouvait tout se dire. J'espérais qu'elle allait toquer à la porte et puis qu'elle allait derrière la porte. On se dit, c'est pas possible, elle aurait pas fugué, on le sait très bien à l'intérieur de nous-mêmes, mais on se dit, pourvu que ce soit ça, quoi. Et puis, petit à petit, on n'espère plus, quoi. Avec le temps qui passe, nous avons compris qu'on ne retrouverait jamais Isabelle. C'était dur. Parce qu'on ne savait pas ce qui lui était arrivé. Est-ce qu'elle était encore vivante? Vous savez, on sait très bien que c'est pas vrai, qu'elle est morte. On garde l'espoir. Parce que une personne qui disparaît, c'est un monde qui s'écroule. On a été dans l'expectative pendant des années, pendant 17 ans. Sans savoir.
juin 2004. Ça fait un an que Michel Fournier est en détention. Monique Olivier, elle est libre. C'était vraiment les derniers interrogatoires possibles. Monique Olivier avec Michel Fournier en détention. Il y a plus de 100 interrogatoires. Fournier et Olivier, plus de 100. Ils ne disent rien. Ils sont interrogés très précisément sur Madame Dupont et puis éventuellement sur d'autres. Ils ne disent rien. Fournier va être libéré.
Si on n'arrive pas à sortir un élément d'enquête qui révèle la commission d'une infraction grave, la Chambre du Conseil va le libérer. On ne peut pas garder quelqu'un si on n'a pas des éléments plus importants. Donc il y a presque un acharnement sur Madame Olivier puisqu'on n'y arrive pas avec Fourniret.
Jeanne-Marie Desrameaux de la région de Charleville, Elisabeth Brichet de Namur, Céline Saison et Manania Tumpong. Je vous signale maintenant d'autres faits dont mon mari s'est rendu coupable et qui ont amené à la mort de deux autres jeunes filles. Le premier cas s'est déroulé dans la région de Nantes. L'autre s'est passé aux environs de Mourmelon.
Les enquêteurs réalisent qu'ils ont affaire à l'activité d'un tueur en série exceptionnel, si on peut le dire ainsi, à un point tel qu'on ne l'imaginait même pas.
On se pose même la question de savoir si elle t'a vu pas. Hein. Parce que c'est tellement en gros ce truc que ça nous dit. On dit parce qu'on arrive le soir à 8 meurtres. On s'est posé la question. On s'est dit, mais ça a paru énorme quand même. Hein.
Pour ce qui est de la prénommée Isabelle, il s'agit du premier meurtre dont j'ai su que Michel était l'auteur. J'ai cru que Michel allait se limiter à la violer. J'ai entendu la gamine hurler, pas très longtemps. Je n'ai pas réagi. Je vais vous dire ce que je sais sur Manania Tumpong. La gamine s'est retrouvée coincée dans le fourgon. Il lui a demandé de se déshabiller. Elle a dû dire à la fin, « Merci, monsieur. » Il m'a dit qu'il l'avait tuée. Jeanne-Marie, Farida, Céline, Elisabeth, elle devait avoir les cheveux blonds, Ninon. Il m'a dit qu'il l'avait enterrée avec la tractopelle. Il m'a expliqué qu'il avait réussi à la pénétrer. Michel m'a dit qu'il avait violé la petite. Il aime qu'on le supplie. J'ai entendu le coup de feu. Il l'a étranglée, il l'a ensuite tuée, il l'a enterrée. Je n'ai pas tenté d'intervenir. J'ai eu peur qu'il fasse la même chose avec moi. J'étais tombée dans son piège.
Il y avait une série d'enlèvements, de meurtres, de viols. C'est abominable. Enfin, c'est indicible. On ne peut pas l'imaginer. On ne peut pas l'imaginer. C'est inouï d'horreur de ce monstre.
Ça a été un choc. C'était terrible. Un prédateur qui vient, qui vous prend votre enfant. C'est quoi ça? C'est quel monde on vit?
C'est la fin des espoirs. On espérait toujours la retrouver. Là, c'était définitif. Il l'a tué. C'était moi qui l'a protégé tout le temps. J'allais le chercher au collège le soir quand il rentrait tard, quand il finissait à 5 heures. Là, j'étais pas là. J'ai pu protéger personne, ni mes parents, ni elle.
Thank you.
fournirait et convoqué à 8h30. Entre-temps, fuite dans la presse.
Un peu absente, un peu malade, Monique Olivier n'a jamais donné l'image d'une femme épanouie. Elle est restée sous l'emprise d'un homme menaçant. Le dénoncer, c'est aussi le quitter.
Fourniret apprend par la radio que Monique Olivier vient de le balancer. Et donc, quand il arrive dans un matin sa convocation, d'entrée, il dit
« J'ai entendu à la radio ce matin que mon nom était cité. Dans le cadre de plusieurs enlèvements ou meurtres de jeunes filles ou de jeunes femmes. Une des qualités de mon épouse est qu'elle ne triche pas.
Ma femme n'a pas dû mentir parce que, je n'aurais plus le terme, mais il n'est pas si doué pour ça. Et puis de toute façon, c'est vrai que je lui ai mis la pression, tout ça c'est le résultat d'un nez de pression que je lui ai mise. En gros, il dédouane déjà sa femme.
Il ne lui a plutôt aucune responsabilité, aucune action dans l'enlèvement et les meurtres qu'il a commis.
Ces déclarations sont en quelque sorte libératoires pour elle, vis-à-vis du despotisme tyrannique que je lui avais imposé depuis que nous vivions ensemble. Elle n'avait pas le choix de refuser ce que je lui imposais, et donc elle l'acceptait par instinct de survie.
Il est clair, il est posé, il a tout ce qu'il a fait, voilà.
Olivier a participé en rien pour lui. Cette meurtre qu'elle nous avoue, en deux, trois jours, elle était la femme soumise, terrorisée, elle ne pouvait rien dire, elle risquait sa vie. Voilà. Ce personnage qui est affiché, l'idiot complètement dépassé par les événements, complètement terrorisé par Fourniret, on était deux, trois, la carte en fait, sa personnalité était autrement plus dépassée. Autrement plus dépassée.
De spaghetti au quatrième étage de la police fédérale, et on est tous d'accord sur le fait de dire
une future mère, puis une mère, a pu être complice d'horreur pareille.
Conscious of sustainability, so I wanted to use all of the scraps to kind of create something that shone a light on climate change, and I wanted it to look like an Arctic landscape.
I'll be honest with you, it was a risk because it could look a little bit old school.
I think the fact that you picked up the scraps was incredible.
Thank you.
The fit looks great. I think the function is there, and I've never seen this before. I mean, I've seen patchwork, but not like this.
Yeah.
So my label in London is a menswear brand, and so this is actually one of the first dresses that I've really kind of done.
Congratulations, but you did a great job.
Thank you.
I agree with Tommy. I think you made scraps look not boho, but couture-y. It's amazing. Women would love this dress because it would be incredibly flattering for a lot of body types. Mm. We're often looking for dresses that have interest up at the top. The whole dress could have been that patchwork, and that would have been incredible.
I really love the menswear look. I think it's so kind of chic and elevated. The balance is fantastic. You've made it look very glamorous.
No small feat, I would say.
Thank you.
Excellent. Well, Daniel, congrats.
Thanks so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, Doc, I really appreciate that you gave us an interesting silhouette.
when she walked down the runway, I could see a pop star in this on a red carpet.
Yes.
They look very strong on the runway. Very strong.
Yeah. I have to compliment you because execution has been an issue in the past, and this is your best execution to date. It's really well done.
Thank you so much.
I like the overlock stitch. That's a cool stitch to use on denim, and I think it would be very wearable. Great at the Met Ball.
Yes.
Yeah, it's a great red carpet dress.
Yes.
My only negative would be it has a little bit of a denim brand feel as opposed to designer.
I have the same sentiment because of the paint sweater. It doesn't look similar to a denim brand.
The bad look in particular, I wish it felt more high-end. But you've done yourself very, very proud.
Thank you so much.
Hi, Ashton. I know how difficult it is to make a woman's trouser.
Yeah.
And when they came on the runway, the first thing I noticed was the pant. The detail, fit, fabric, I think they're epic.
That's incredible. I really appreciate it.
Look at them. They're amazing.
Thank you.
I wanted to do a play on like a traditional hakama, but the back being much more fitted, tailored, flattering, and not so frumpy in the back.
The fit was amazing.
Thank you.
I love the waistband. I love the top. I love the snaps.
I also had sleeves on this today to cut them off.
Did you? Not yet. I think it's
immediately at that we're doing it on, and I just chopped them off.
I think you've nailed it.
Thank you.
But I wish you had done a little more of the dark on this side.
Yeah.
Maybe here, or maybe here.
I would agree. The only thing I would say, potentially the harness shape does look familiar to me.
Mm.
Can I say I would 100% use that look on the red carpet? These are just fantastic, and they're restrained, and I think they're your best looks yet.
Thank you so much.
Mitchu, do you think you've done enough to really entice us to want to see more?
I think I can bring out more than this, for sure.
Yeah.
I really tried to push myself to make it what I love.
Yeah. When I saw this doctor come down the runway, I was impressed because you've given us a runway look. I love it.
Really?
Me too. I'm always looking for things that are really striking on the red carpet, and I think these absolutely fit the bill for that. Mm-hmm. Incredibly strong, and I have a lot of clients who would want to wear that.
Thank you so much.
I think the biggest thing you have going for you is that you have a uniqueness that could always be yours.
Oh,
and I think that if you look at the stores in the world, mm-hmm. you're not going to see this.
Oh my God, it's all goosebumps, and down there's my leg is shaking.
The only thing I wonder is how difficult it's going to be to wear the pant. It might be a little shorter a little bit, but I think, look, how wearable is it?
Me too. There are four very, very strong designers here, so I wish you good luck. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
There we have it. The semi-finals.
It's a very difficult decision. You've got a lot of talent here.
Yeah.
And I think at least every one of them had one great look.
Yeah, totally. Let's kick off by talking about Pinju.
I thought it was very modern. I like the construction. Mm-hmm. And I love the zippers at the back.
But I really believe it's an example of something that's going to be next in fashion.
Agreed, yeah. Okay, let's move on to Angel.
That bleached kind of paint effect maybe looked a little familiar.
It had a great runway presence, and it was her best execution to date, which is significant.
Yes.
Okay, so let's talk about Daniel.
I liked the patching of the straps together. I thought it looked well made, and I haven't really seen that out there yet. So I thought it was very good.
As a stylist, I often hear inspirations, and they often have nothing to do with the clothes you're looking at. His always connects to what he's done.
Yes.
And I love what he did.
Sure.
Yeah.
Let's go. Ashton. He is a craftsman. He has never let us down when it comes to construction.
The high-waisted trousers, I think, were a home run. I thought the men's looked too familiar. I've seen the harness, Prada, and Gucci.
Okay, we have to send two designers home. Decide on which two designers will move forward to the finale. We all agree on who should move forward, I assume?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. That's enough.
In their place, in the next in fashion finale,
is. Minju.
Angel and Ashton, I need you to know that you guys are
forging and so exhausting, but also so beautiful. I have worked and been creative next to people that I've never met globally, been inspired by them, and that is priceless. You can't really put.
I can't believe it.
My true vision, and I already know what I'm going to do. It's been in my head actually for the whole competition. I'm inspired by the Bright Young Things. They were a group of high society socialites in London in the 1920s, and they did these crazy fancy dress parties, and it was all about kind of being whoever you wanted to be, and kind of want this collection to embody that spirit, and each look in the collection will be a different character. I've come up with a lot of ideas, but really it's like 10 men's looks. Like, I think I need to do a dress.
Yeah.
Can you make something for me?
You're not gonna wear it, I think.
I would wear it.
Well, Halloween. My concept is Frida Kahlo, the most famous feminist painter in the world, I think. I always wish to make a collection inspired by her. This finale is my chance to make whatever I want. So I'll be for it. I'm gonna make lots of dresses, and I want to use lots of color. Feminine, elegant, and definitely it will be about the volume. This is what inspires me. Yeah, it makes me really happy, mean too. You know? Oh my god, doing my collection. Yeah, I like that.
Oh, guys, we've got a lot to do. What I've started with today is like my base pieces. So like there's a pair of jeans that we'll do a few different colours of, and some silk shirts that we'll do a few different colours of. I've done the pattern for the jeans and the shirt, so we can just start now whilst I figure out what the rest of the collection is going to look like. My strategy making the collection is to start with my base, trousers, jeans, shirts and jerseys, and then I'll build on top of it. The collection comprises of 4 women's looks and 6 men's looks. Today, my focus will really be on my men's looks. That's my strength. Let's just go crack in. I've got this amazing team of sewers to help me produce this collection. So if you could just trace that off. When I work on my collections, normally, I'm not sitting behind a sewing machine sewing the whole thing. There's a team. So you'll cut like this, yeah. So to make an entire collection in 3 days, I need their help to get this done.
I didn't know I'm gonna be the finalist. That was really not ready for it. I just worry about myself. Making 10 looks, honestly, we need like 2 months. So to have a successful collection in this finale, every single second will be really, really important. If I have idea, I have to just go for it. I'm thinking about using lots of jacquard and flower fabric. But the thing is, I'm always doubting myself. Is it good or not? Questioning forever. Shall we just run? This is gonna be definitely a difficult challenge for me. By end of today, I hope I'm gonna have 4 looks today. Now I'm working on the long skirt with apron top with the country flower print.
I was gonna just stitch in the ditch here, but I have to wait until the fire's too out.
Oh,
Daniel.
Hi.
So, this time, 10 looks, the world is your oyster.
Yes.
What are you choosing for your feet?
There's like a lot of different things going on here. Each look is going to be a different character. There's going to be a look which is inspired by horse riding. Like, I'm going to add stars to the shirt. Also, I'm going to add a pig snout to one of them.
Pig snout? Oh my god, they're doing piggery on the runway.
Yeah. I'm also going to do a look which is all stripes. There's going to be tailoring. natural beige dry suit inspired by the jockey.
Do you ever use anything as kind of acidy?
No, I wanted this collection to just kind of embody that spirit of freedom. What really speaks to me about the Bright Young Things is their attitude towards life. They embrace this spirit of being whatever you want to be and doing whatever you want to do. Growing up, it was hard to do that. I was always the kid who was matching my socks with my t-shirt, and being in a small town, there was not really much fashion around me. Saying that I wanted to do fashion was like me saying, yeah, I'm gay, actually. And I think that put me off going into it. It wasn't until I kind of moved down to London that I kind of stopped caring what people think. I came out and I was like, yeah, I want to be a fashion designer. Friends say to me that my personality changed when I came out because it was like something had been lifted and I became more open and freer. Not worrying what people think about you allows you to be more creative.
My store is working on like white pants, which is in really beautiful green.
The back, did you want that stitched down too?
Yeah. Little bit. I'm also gonna make a pair of really historical, like a pattern pants. So that's two pants. They're with it underneath dresses. It looks like a scarf. Yeah, I think it's nice.
I decided to add a star onto the back of these jeans. I mean, who doesn't want a star on their ass?
Hello, Minju.
Hi, Minju.
Whoa, look at that. So it's a Frida Kahlo inspired collection.
Yeah, I'm doing only female because Frida Kahlo is all about really strong women, like, you know, superpower.
Yeah.
Also, I really love the Mexican tradition look. For example, Frida Kahlo always wears the scarf and the shawl around, so I want to use
confidence,
yeah,
and whether she's going to get lost in second guessing herself.
Yes.
And then secondly, that relates to time management. She moves like a glacial pace.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, guys. I'm changing that.
Okay.
Nice. They look really good.
Daniel's done quite a lot already. We've got the black shirt, a cummerbund, a pair of white jeans, star jeans, and the pink shirt with the stars.
Yeah.
He's also cut out the jersey for the stripe.
He has. The only thing I'm worried about with Daniels is he pushing himself enough with the jeans and the shirts? Because that is what he does in his regular business today.
Oh my god. It really is a star on the ass. I've designed 6 looks so far, and they're all men's looks. And I've not designed any of the women's looks because I'm absolutely terrified. I'm going to try and do that next.
This challenge is lots of pressure because I want to do it really good. So I have to check everything. Even today I wasted so much time.
Oh, it's really good.
Okay guys, it's tools down for the day.
2 days of work left before you unleash your collections to the world.
See you tomorrow.
Good luck.
Daniel. Morning.
Morning. At the top of day 2. I feel like we're in a good place. We've got like the base of a lot of things started. This I love, by the way. This is really nice. We'll wait and do waistband until we fit models. And then maybe you want to carry on with the trousers. And then I'm gonna work on a new pattern now. So good luck, guys. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay guys. I'm very nervous because I have kind of 4 looks, but everything is not finished. I see Daniel's mannequin. I feel like he does 6 looks somehow.
Slow down, Daniel!
Daniel, you've got so many.
Don't panic, Minju. Nothing I have done is anywhere near as complicated as those dresses. Stitch them together afterwards.
It really looks amazing.
Beautiful. Sewn by my own fair hands.
Models!
Welcome back.
Oh my god, I have only 5 looks. I don't know why they called 10 models today.
So many. Go back. No, I don't want you guys. Oh my god. Hi guys.
I don't feel ready at all.
You look great.
Yeah, that's nice.
Let's see the coat. I'm really happy with the models I hear today because you don't always know what's going to work until you see it come together on a person. I'm not sure about this colour on here, to be honest. I feel like maybe you guys could swap. Alice is really nice to me.
Oh yeah, I think the length is really nice on you.
Minju!
Hi!
How's it going?
Trying my best.
Good!
the, you know, the long pole.
So I'm making like long pole with
coffee
sleeve.
So this is the one, the final.
Yeah. Can I put it on you?
Yes. Looks nice already.
I'm also gonna make really the oversized dress with a mesh print. So very exciting.
Hey Daniel.
Hey.
Hi dear, how are you?
I'm all right.
How are you coping?
Like, actually, got quite a lot done.
Should we line them up?
Yeah.
Okay.
Can we line up?
Let's line up, please, you guys. We've got a shot of colour. How do you feel about it?
I think the colouring is wrong for him.
Okay, next.
What we need to do here is we just need to attach the waistband.
Yeah.
I think the star looks good.
Yeah. Okay, so this is going to be your showstopper.
Yeah, I've taken like a 50s gown. Almost like we just cut it off and twisted it around.
I just hope it's going to be strong enough to deliver the impact you want it to. Because if it doesn't, it's just a very nice dress.
Yeah. His comments are a bit concerning. I need some time to digest it myself. I was getting karma before you came. Okay, I'm going to cancel the black dress. It doesn't have the wow factor that it needs to be a showstopper. I want to take it to a new place.
I think it's going to work better in silver because it's going to have this shape a bit more.
So I'm going to make it in this stiff, shiny silver fabric. But to do that in this time frame, pretty insane.
Finale look is this. So my showstopper is going to be the wedding dress, but I want to bring out very soft and modern. I'm going to use white, like a jacquard with lots of volume, and I want to use like lots of tulle. At the end, it has to be really elegant dress that all the girls want to wear for their wedding dress. Because it takes 1 month to make the wedding dress, but I'm gonna make it in 2 days. You cut the off.
Yeah.
Ah, okay. Come on, hurry.
So you're just altering the jeans so that they will fit Veronica.
Yeah. Yeah, pink jacket looks really great. I love it.
Okay, guys.
Designers, you have just 1 hour left.
Believe it's the last day tomorrow.
I'm gonna just cut quickly.
I'm working on my second dress, and I found this amazing hand beaded fabric. It's really gonna add an element of luxury, but for me, it's too perfect for the theme. Like a hammer. I want to reflect the debaucherous, mad, witty spirit of the Bright Young Things. So I'm gonna take a hammer to it.
I feel a bit nervous doing this because if I mess it up or it looks terrible, there's no going back.
Oh god. Let's go. Let's do this.
Ooh.
Sorry, Minju.
How does it look?
I think it's turned out nicely. Looks much more beautiful.
1 minute left, guys. 1 minute to the end of the day.
I think I have 6 looks done today. And tomorrow I have to work on 4 looks. Yara. Then.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. We actually made a lot of clothes in this amount of time. Smashed it. High five.
I worry about my wedding gown. This fresh type of one more layer, but I'm just worried it's too simple. I'm scared of tomorrow.
The day of the runway show, and I've still got to make one whole look from scratch. It's more important that we get all the looks constructed.
Right.
But of course, I need to do all of the finishing. Can you write a list as we go along? It's a lot of work to do in one day. The coat needs tuxedo buttons, paint edges, the vent needs pressing. Fit trousers, finish top and skirt, add buttons, collar on jersey. Trousers need poppers on, paint edges, top stitching around the edge, needs a pocket, needs buttons, and a hem. The only thing that is completely finished that is in the white cummerbund. Ah.
take the smallest, or two or four,
two.
Like that.
Yeah.
Okay.
The size, I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we can start taking.
Yeah. I'm really proud of what I made for the finale. We have six looks done for sure. This one you have to work on it.
Okay.
Yeah. And so we're so working on the finishing for the coat and corset dress, and also the mesh dress with my print and the jersey dress. And this wedding dress, I have to do this. Yes. The most important right now is time management. All the stores are really busy working with my collection, and I'm gonna really focus on the wedding dress.
Yeah, feel a bit panic.
Okay. The pants look is gonna have a completely new look. So I think what I'm gonna do is do, like, if you imagine like a sailor jersey, then a shirt coming out underneath, blue cotton stripe, and then some like boxer style shorts. So I need to basically do the pattern for that. The pressure is really on. If that's concerning, I've got a lot to do. We're good? I am freaking out a bit.
Wedding dress is the most important part of this collection, so I want to do something innovation, not just you've seen before. Daniel,
yeah,
I'm thinking I'm gonna make it something like it's a cape around your face, but at the end it has to be really elegant dress.
And then you put it there, and then you become a dress.
And then when she releases it, it's gonna be long train veil.
But the thing is, when you take it off, it become like this on the floor.
Yeah.
Like, this is not mine. It has to be flat, right? But I don't know how it's going to do that.
Should I keep off this?
That's so nice on the face, though.
And it's not nice without the gather.
Maybe you could hem it and put a string in it.
Yeah.
And then you pull it along the string. And when she pulls it up, she pulls the string out.
Ooh.
And then the whole thing is released.
That was a genius!
Okay.
Yeah,
now go
that
make
one
it.
Is
go
that
make
one.
It.
Okay.
Now I have to do it. Don't think, Minju, just move your hand.
Being here for all this time and doing all of these challenges has renewed my passion and my love for what I do. Before I came into the competition, what I was doing was not about fashion anymore, it was about running a business. I went into having my own brand really quickly when I started the label 3 years ago, just fresh out of college, which was a crazy step. I've had to learn how to run a business, which is something that I was never trained to do. This competition has kind of reminded me that I love being a fashion designer, and running a business has taken away from that a little bit. If I was to win that money, creatively, what I could do, I think, would be huge. This is it, guys. Last push.
I got 5
left. Oh, yeah. 40 minutes to the run, Chef. 40 minutes to stick it.
Models!
I'm good. You can do it. Perfect. Oh, God, yes.
Desires 5 minutes to run away.
Hi, we have to hurry. We have to dress up. When you stand, like, you know, just try to keep the volume, like, don't press it down, all right?
Can we get a pin? Can we get a pin?
Don't tape. Don't tape. We have to hurry!
Good morning.
I would step on the gal. Grand finale. Very happy to see some familiar faces here.
Yes, hello.
Hi, welcome back.
Hi, guys. We are so thrilled to have you all here with us. This really is a proud moment for us, and especially big for our two brilliant finalists who are still working their way back, so just working these.
Hurry up.
Let's go.
We have to now.
That's it. Okay, so just remember, like, your walk is strong, it's powerful.
Alexa and I will be critiquing keeping the lock. But as usual, we have a judging panel that's packed with some of the most influential individuals in fashion today. We have Instagram's pioneer of fashion, Eva Chen, stylist of the stars, Elizabeth Stewart, and global buying director for Net-a-Porter, Elizabeth Vondergotts. Hi.
Elizabeth, Net-a-Porter is synonymous with getting luxury fashion into everyone's closets around the world. What are you looking for?
We're looking for a designer that has a unique point of view. We ship to over 170 countries.
That's amazing.
So we bring in a new brand, it has to really stand out from the other 700 fashion brands we have on the site.
So Eva, can you tell us about the power of an Instagram moment?
Well, nowadays in fashion, it has to stand out on Instagram for it to have an impact. You know, millions of people around the world are going to see it. It's something that can make or break a career, I think.
Let's give these incredible bosses a huge round of applause.
Okay, we have to hurry.
You can sign in.
Now you know who the judges are, but there are still two incredibly important people that you are yet to meet. Let the finale runway begin.
Okay, everyone, stand by.
The pressure is really on.
Okay, will everybody please get in line?
The audience is full. We've got Net-a-Porter, we've got Instagram, we've got influencers, our families, the designers. There's a lot of people that we need to impress.
Trey, facade, get in your order.
But that is the moment that I live for.
Stand by.
I think is interesting.
I actually love the shirt. I would wear the shirt in a heartbeat.
Yeah, you would
wear that shirt. I would.
That shirt has tan prints written all over it.
Ooh. I love the sheerness. I love the coat over it.
He literally took a hammer to this dress.
$650 a yard for this fabric, and he smashed the shit out of it.
Looks a little thrown together.
It's my least favorite. It's a little too simple for me. I'm not sure what he's trying to say with it.
Last model. Stand by. Go.
silver really
good. Yeah, it's a pretty small fabric choice.
It's a showstopper.
And the quirky cut would have made it more modern. Because it could be like just the typical ball gown.
Star Trek meets the 1920s.
Daniel, incredible work. We are so impressed. How are you feeling?
Oh, I can't believe it's done. That was like the craziest show I've ever done. It felt amazing.
And as you know, we have your family here with us today. Hello, family. How are you feeling?
I've never experienced anything like this, and I would not have missed it for the world.
Good. And Dad, I know you're from the north. I know you're a man of very few words.
I don't know how he can get up there and speak. But he hasn't got it from me.
But
yeah,
from
so
me.
Proud.
Daniel, you are amazing. We love you so much.
Oh.
Oh.
God, I'm gonna cry.
You've made us so proud. Thank you.
Thank you. Right, so I had to work how much this whole experience has meant to me and how much it's changed me as a person. And thank you for having me.
And thank you for being here with us. You blew us away. We are honestly so, so proud of you.
Thank you.
Okay, everyone, let's hear it one more time, please, for Daniel Fletcher.
Today is honestly very emotional, you know?
Of the lineup.
I feel like all this competition, I was really always not confident about myself.
Can you help me? Like, because she said it's keep dropping.
But I know that. I worked really hard for the challenge to do this. I'm so proud of myself. This is really like beautiful moment in my life.
Stand by. Model is set.
She did it so beautifully.
Love this coat. That's just come on. You go to the Met Gala in
that. That is a Fashion Week coat.
Right.
Like that's the coat that like fueled a million Instagrams.
Yes.
Done.
This is a beautiful graphic. I think it's maybe a bit oversimplified around the neck.
dressing for herself and for other women versus for a man.
Totally.
This is also her pregnancy. She used her pregnancy to different fabrics.
In my work, I'm often trying to hide pregnancies.
That's brilliant.
Yeah.
Please go off.
But it doesn't actually make you look large, which is so hard to do when you're in volume.
Last model.
Signatures were there in force, looking amazing. The hand painting, the architectural designs, the layers.
I think that's what's so wise about his design is that he infuses every one of his looks with a kiss of Daniel. You always know that's a Daniel look. I love the collection. It's fashion forward, it's interesting, but it's very much wearable. He blew me away. Without him saying one word, we know what his reference point is, and that's a strong designer.
Yes. I think it was really saleable, and coming from a perspective of just Marc Jacquard and all of that. Like, there were lots of things that were really wearable that a woman can put on, that a man can put on, and sort of easy.
And you can see all the young, cool Insta girls wanting to wear it. You know, like, they'll wear it out, they'll wear it out to dinner, they'll wear it clubbing.
Yeah.
It's like 24/7, you can wear that collection.
Yeah.
Okay, let's talk about the chausson, which is the silver dress with the cravat detail, which I really loved because it linked in really nicely with the cummerbund.
Yes.
I did think, wow, that's an incredible creation.
I love the uneven hemline. It's actually executed perfectly from a craftsmanship point of view. Yeah, absolutely. And the fabric, the silver, just really was beautiful.
Yeah.
It's
not easy to work with shiny fabric. We've all seen shiny fabric horror stories, but like, I think he did it very well, and the fit was perfect.
Oh, let's talk about Minju. She said that she wanted to create an experience that was joyful, that made us happy. She nailed it.
And it's very now. We notice her influences from other designers, but I think she takes them and really makes them her own.
I mean, I see hundreds of brands every season. We see like maybe 1,000, I don't even know how many, and that actually stood out as something different and unique and really beautiful.
She's very unique, and the whole thing is just an enticing offering. You want to step into her world.
Okay, that showstopper actually made me gasp. Instagram would go nuts.
Yeah.
Hey, take your job.
It would go viral 100%.
It was chic, it was grown up, it was sexy in her way.
Mm-hmm.
It was a new aesthetic for her, I felt, and I was really proud of it.
Okay, you guys, I think we've come to a decision. Let's talk.
Minju pulled it off so beautifully. I'm just so happy that she actually got it all out. Minju and Daniel, how they've done and they pull this off, I would never know. For like past 10 collections, she has been holding so much because I'm the one running the business. So when she goes too far, then I have to stop her, you know? I felt so bad because now I see all this collection and I feel so sorry. I might be the one stopping her being free.
Daniel and Minju, you came to this competition with a hunger to win. And now, here you are in the grand finale.
Daniel, it was the party you never wanted to leave. These bright young things are shining bright tonight. I think your greatest strength is your curiosity. It really imbues your clothes with this magic. You're such an intelligent designer. Your narratives are always so strong, as is your construction, the fabrics, everything. You've been so, so impressive throughout this competition. And this pièce de résistance is really something you should be proud of.
I was so impressed. This collection, it is so wearable. I love the way you styled everything. The show-stopping finale dress, I mean, like, I want to wear that right now. This feels like a celebration of fashion, so I really love it. Well done.
You really showed kind of your DNA run throughout, so those painted hands, your attention to detail, the covered buttons, all of that.
And that's something in Etiquette we always look for. And I think you did that in such a beautiful and thoughtful way. So congratulations.
Minju, this confectionery cake treasure box that's going on over here. I mean, it's so beautiful, so moving. I think it had this kind of quiet power to it. And even though it's ultra feminine, it also feels ultra strong. I think we're redefining what it means to do feminine dressing.
Minju, your collection had that alchemy and magic that really makes an impactful runway show. And it really brought a huge smile to my face. It was joyous, it was vibrant, as everyone said. And thank you for that.
Minju, you skewed my idea of what cool and sexy is. I now see sexy as whatever Minju Kim wants sexy to be. And that's really, really impressive. Well done, that's a lot to pull off in one collection.
We have reached our final decision.
For one of you, life is about to change forever in the most incredible way. The winner is... Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
That was amazing. What an incredible night.
Oh, Cryaga. Yeah. What are you waiting for, people? Press the button.
Yeah.
Go. Check out the next one. It's going to be fantastic.
No. It's over. I won.
Oh. Well, yeah. Then go back and watch the whole thing over again. You're going to love it. It's even better than the sound.
Well, yeah.
Come on.
Life-changing prize.
You blew my mind. This is Mess and Fashion.
Wow, wow, wow.
Nobody can stop this.
Wow.
This is crazy.
Oh my god.
I'm Godoy. I'm from Inglewood, California. I design for drag queens. They make it all. Swimsuits to evening gowns. They're all high fashion. Next in fashion.
It's my signature. It's my signature.
I'm Eliana Batsakis. I'm 24 years old and I'm from Cincinnati, Ohio. I actually just started sewing 4 years ago.
I'm a bit nervous, but I feel ready.
So looking around at the competition, you know, it's kind of intimidating because like so many people have such amazing experience. I just know that I'm calling to, like, be a fashion designer.
Oh, guys, oh my god.
fashion. First off, I'd like to introduce you to supermodel, style icon, designer, and all-around fashion force. You know who it is? It's Gigi Hadid! Together, you represent the best and brightest of the future of fashion.
We're not looking for what was yesterday in fashion or what is now in fashion. Pay attention to the title, people. Fashion moves fast, right? We're looking for the next in fashion.
That's right, that's right. Some of you have attended prestigious fashion schools, and some of you are completely self-taught. The only thing that matters is what you send down our gorgeous runway.
Courtney, tell us about yourself. What's your story, DeAndre?
I'm from the nation's capital, Washington, D.C. I went to school in San Francisco, California, at the Academy Art University. Unfortunately, I didn't get to finish, but I'm here to claim my prize.
Yes! We love a confident one.
But to be honest,
yes,
everything before doesn't matter. What happens here is what's going to determine which of your lives changes dramatically.
But only one of you will be next in fashion, and that designer will win something incredibly special. Ready for it?
Yes!
Rent the Runway, the premier fashion destination serving up the hottest designs and trends in a more sustainable, affordable way, will award the winner of Next in Fashion $200,000. I know, isn't that so impressive?
$200,000. So I have a job in fashion, but my bigger dreams are to work for myself. I don't be wanting to work for the man. So I need the coins.
That's not all. The winning designer will also be given the opportunity to launch their collection on Rent.